turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols. So give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us now lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us now
fails? Is there anyone that falls? Am I the only one in church today feeling so small? 'Cause when I take a look around, everybody seems so strong. I know they'll soon discover that I don't belong. So I tuck it all away like everything's okay. If I make them all believe it, walk away.
falls. Am I the only one in church today feeling so small?
Church today.
so small. 'Cause when I take a look around, everybody seems so strong. I know they'll soon discover that I don't belong. So I tuck it all away, like everything's okay. If I make them all believe it, maybe I'll believe it too. So with a painted grin, I play the part again. So everyone will see me the way that I see them. Are we happy plastic people under shiny plastic steeple? With walls around our weakness and smiles to hide our pain. But if the invitation's open to every heart that has been broken, maybe then we close the curtain on our stained glass masquerade.
Is there anyone who's been there? Are there any hands to raise? Am I the only one who's traded in the altar for a stage?
Am I the only one in church today feeling so small?
Kind of smiling faces. I can see your smiling eyes, you know, for those of you in person. We've been doing this wonderful song called House of the Lord lately. I just wanted to give you a little information about it. Phil Wickham wrote this song just this year as he was coming back into the presence of the Lord in his sanctuary at his home church, and he's seeing all these people gathered once more. So I love how full we are and how we have all this extra people in the fellowship room and in the gym and all these other people online. It is great to have you all together. So let's stand and sing about being in the house of the Lord together.
Thank you.
his praise. I'll tell you, the last couple weeks of the message and the themes has been very interesting to choose songs. So we're as we think about all of the different elements of what Paul has brought us in Romans, we also think about God's amazing love and what he has done for us and how much it is baffling that we can gain from what he did for us. Let's sing about that.
Thank you. Thank you, dear daughter Melanie and our worship team. Let's just give thanks to the Lord. Father, we have been expressing from the depths of our hearts the praise that you are due. Thank you for sending Jesus to be our sin bearer, to be our lion and lamb, to deal with those things inside of us we could not change, but only you could. And we just celebrate that today here gathered in this place, in our living rooms at home, in overflow. Thank you just we could be together in your presence in these moments. And we ask, Father, you'll speak in your special way to each person, each of us in our need. We come before you in anticipation and with thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Special blessing to those of you sitting over there in overflow, and we were asking that people just kind of take a turn in there once a month or so and just kind of cycle it so we can different people in here, because we're meeting our capacity in here, a couple seats over here, we just want to be able to fit people in. A few things to note. The nursery loft is upstairs, and when we dismiss a little later for our children time and student time downstairs, the toddlers can also go down into the fellowship room downstairs with parents and be watched there. There's live stream into that room as well. Last Sunday, there were a number of shoeboxes up here, and more were added, so 97 shoeboxes went to the distribution center. 97 shoeboxes. And one goat, all right? And one goat. So that filled out the gifts that went through Samaritan's Purse. I'm so grateful for that. Our season of Advent starts next week. And so we will begin with a new series. And a number of angels distributed invitations like this in the mailboxes surrounding our church neighborhood here. So thank you for those that made that possible yesterday and walked to bring a blessing into mailboxes. And we just want to invite people. And there's a bunch of these in the foyer. If you want to take one and drop it off to a friend, a family member, a neighbor, and say, hey, come join us, either live stream or here. We've still got more room to settle out in the gym. And, you know, but whether in whatever hybrid way, let's celebrate Advent services together. And Christmas caroling is going to happen again this year, headed up by Don and Karen Stauffer, who are over there in the overflow. And that'll be December 15, a Wednesday, and December 20, a Monday. And so you might want to keep those in mind. We'll get information out for you on that. And finally, I just want to mention, we celebrate the homegoing of Nathan Kowalski's grandfather. Where's Nathan? There he is. Went to be with the Lord this week. It's been a family time, our vigil around his bed in the hospital, and saying goodbye is not easy, but there's a great hope that we share in the Lord. And we'll just pray for that family and for Grandma, who married to Grandpa for 64 years, and seeing him, saying goodbye to him, I'm sure is not easy, as some of you can attest. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your grace to us in these things. Thank you that even as we celebrate and we think about the things that are coming and Advent and the birth of Jesus and how central that is and important that is in the celebration of our faith, we just thank you that we can look forward to these things and pray that you'd, Lord, help us bear that glad message, along with believers around the city, to bear that glad message that Jesus came. And we look forward to the ways that will get celebrated and that Jesus will be lifted high. Lord, meanwhile, even this week, we thank you for ministries that have been taking place in the past week and that will take place this coming week with children and with students, with, Lord, with small groups and support groups and all the things that we're trying to roll out and encourage for the fellowship and discipleship of your church family. We ask for your blessing in all of that. And for the offerings that have been, Lord, readily given in recognition of the priority of your ministry here locally, and the missionaries that we support in different parts of the world, we just pray that, Lord, each dollar would bring a blessing in what is intended, and that by your Spirit you'd apply it and use it, help us to use it wisely. Thank you, Father, for Nathan, Alicia, for the family. Lord, even as now as they, Lord, have a heavy heart for what's happened in their family, and yet a glad heart for the joy that is his grandfather's, even now in your presence. We just pray your comfort, your peace to surround that family, even as they have the visiting and the service this coming week. And we just ask, Father, for your grace in their lives. And Lord, all these things we lift up in the glorious name of Jesus. Amen. I should mention, but I'll put in an email for those that would like to visit with the Kowalski family. It's going to be at Grace, not here, but Grace Christian Reformed Church in Welland. 2 to 4 on Tuesday is the visiting time, and 1 o'clock on Wednesday, the service. And we'll put that in the email as well. I think I'm going to turn it back over to my sweet daughter, Melanie. All right.
Yes. Please stand with us as we sing about our holy, holy, holy God that we worship. Children, you are free to go with Pastor Bruce, and teens up to grade 9, I believe, are free to go out with Pastor Terry. If you want to stay, you're welcome, but there is also fun things for you out there, just like there are fun things for us in here.
All right, are we on here? Yes, we are. Okay, we're going to start with a little poll, and you can answer on a scale of 1 absolutely to 5 absolutely not. I could just go with 1 or 5, I would just, you know, 2 things, but we're Canadian, right? So we don't like to really commit to something like that. So depending on how much coffee we've had in our day, it might be 2, you know, like, you know, 2 would be usually, or 4, seldom. And if we didn't have any coffee today, it might be in the middle, like maybe. But here's the question. Are you tired of COVID restrictions? Okay, yeah, not a hard question, right? But let me just get our mental responses here on my neural perception scanner app here. And so we're just going to kind of give us a read. Ready? Here we go. Okay. Yeah. Here we go. Okay, it binged, but you couldn't hear that. That's good. Good. Results are in. Here we go. So 82% said 1. Like, we're absolutely tired of these restrictions, right? 11% said 2. So usually, probably the ones who are, you know, still very concerned about catching COVID from someone else, and I get that. 4% said 3, that's a maybe, and I suppose those are the people who enjoy working from home and hope it'll stay that way, right? And 3% said 4, which is like seldom, and so you're, you know, maybe the ones who are enjoying that stores aren't so busy and maybe it's helping keep you safer. And so no one said absolutely not. 5, all right, so that's good. A couple people thought about it, it says, but you hope that, you know, maybe like in case I got you to raise your hand, you didn't want to do that, so you didn't say it. Anyway, so there you go. There's the poll. Now, you know I'm completely making that up, right? Yeah, okay. Which goes to show you you can't fully trust opinion polls, and you can't trust the opinions of those who, you know, try to give their opinions on the results. But anyway. The reason for that little exercise, thank you for cooperating, is that we've come to the Epistle of the Romans, and the inspired writer is responding to some opinions about what is right and what is wrong and what God likes and what God hates. And in chapter 1, after Paul's introduction, his great declaration of being unashamed of the gospel, you know, the God's powerful instrument of life transformation through believing in Jesus. Well, then he launches into this long and nasty list of just, you know, the depraved, evil world that we live in and the people that so desperately need the gospel. Bad enough that he has to make a list, but he's careful to remain non-threatening in his language. Like, he's talking about they and about them, right? Like, they are without excuse, and they knew God, but they didn't honor him, and they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened, and they became fools, and, you know, God gave them up, and God gave them up, and God gave them up, right? And if Paul were to ask you, do you believe that people are deserving of his judgment? Those bad people, do they deserve God's judgment? What are you thinking? Oh, here we go. And it, hold on for it. Ready? That Bing didn't say, but he got the results. So here we go. 99.7 said yes. Oh, okay, so we're kind of in agreement on that. 0.3% said maybe. And calculations, that's one person here. All right, so I don't know who you are, but listen closely. Yeah. No, most of us would concur that God's righteous decree in chapter 1, verse 32, is that those who practice such things deserve to die. And likely most of us would be feeling considerable relief that Paul was pointing at them, right? Outsiders to the grace of God, with little knowledge of God. You know, that we might be feeling a little proud of our knowledge of God and his ways compared to them, And that is until suddenly in chapter 2, Paul spins the pronoun a full 180 degrees, right? From the outward pointing third person to the second person, you. Me? Uh-oh. What do we do? And through chapter 1, we might have been, okay, preach it, Paul, you know? Say it like it is, brother. But starting in chapter 2, Paul puts you and me, the readers of this text, the readers of his letter, he puts us on trial as he emphasizes God's verdict on all sin. And so what will become very clear to us are these three truths that are brought out in Charles Swindoll's commentary. I liked how he said it. God's judgment is inescapable. God's judgment is impartial. And God's judgment is universal. Well, Marge Andres is going to come and read for us chapter 2, verse 1 through 16. Thanks.
Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hand and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress. For every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first, and also the Greek. For God shows no partiality. For all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law, and all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not the hearers of the law who were righteous before God, but the doers of the law who would be justified. For when Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they do not have the law. They show that the work of the law is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness, and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them. On that day, when according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus.
Thanks, Marge. Well, let's unpack these three paragraphs, taking that sweep, starting with the inescapable nature of God's judgment. This is a core truth that the rest of the section kind of builds out from. The Apostle Paul is declaring that a verdict of God's judgment on sin is specifically that he judges our actions, he shows no partiality, that all have sinned, and that he will judge every hidden motive in secret. Hebrews 9:27 says it's appointed for a man to die once, and after that comes judgment. But do we believe that God is going to judge the world? I could do my scanner. I'll pause on that one. But I think it would show that we'd be pretty solid agreement on that one. That though we may not be sure of the how and the when, we'd be in agreement. But you know, most people highly doubt that. We live in a time of relativism and pluralism, kind of tolerance and diversity, an age in which everyone does what is right in their own eyes. So if we were to do a poll, say at Costco, pretty busy place, and we just ask people, do you believe in a universal day of judgment for the human race? We'd likely be asked to leave If I got my scanner out, they'd probably tackle me as security. But anyway, but if we did get answers, it would likely be, well, I don't believe a God of love is going to judge anybody. Or maybe, you know, I'm not worried about it because I'm just as good as the next person. Or the optimist might say, well, I'll take my chances. Or, hey, I'm okay and you're okay. We're all okay. Stop worrying about it. Well, that's the kind of person that Paul is talking about starting in chapter 2. It's the person who maybe heartily agreed with Paul, that graphic parade of sins in chapter 1, perhaps as much as we did when I preached it over the last couple of sermons. You know, I mean, it's always nice to come to church and hear the preacher condemn someone else's sin, right? Maybe you leave feeling better about yourself than when you came in because you know the words weren't aimed at you. So this sermon is really for all those amen brothers and hallelujah sisters that cheered me on, cheer on this teaching, you know, as much as it's for the outsider who might be appalled at the sinful lifestyles of others who rightly say, hey, I don't live that way. Like, don't paint me with that brush. Like, those words don't apply to me. I'm a good moral person. Well, if any of those shoes fit, that's who Paul is addressing right now. This isn't the Jewish-Gentile split. That does come up in his teaching, but Paul doesn't really single out Jewish people in particular until verse 17. And so chapter 2, verse 1 to 16 isn't addressing the Jewish person any more than chapter 1, verse 18 to 32 is singling out the Gentiles. Because not all Gentiles were immorally evil and not all Jews were morally good. Who does Paul address? Again, it's the you. When I point this way, it's three pointing back, right? It's you, O man, who judges others for the things you do yourself. He's talking about straight up hypocrisy. God doesn't judge on a curve. He judges according to truth. And the truth is that all have sinned. It's not those who show a lot of badness that get God's judgment. Chapter 1, verse 18 is clear that God's wrath is revealed from heaven against all, say all unrighteousness and ungodliness. Not just the worst kinds. In fact, how do you even know what the worst kinds are, right? Our measuring stick isn't like God's measuring stick. In reality, sin is a very subtle beast. We get deceived by it. A moralizer, that's the kind of person he's talking about here, doesn't tend to do exactly the same things that he or she is judging in others. Many people, including Christians, define sin as the sum total of acts that they themselves do not commit. For example, while the moralizer may not be, as chapter 1, verse 26, 27 was talking about, homosexual practice, it doesn't mean that he or she has dealt with all the disordered affections in their lives, right? Or that they haven't dabbled in private affairs of the mind that would clearly be dishonorable passion if those got played out. Ray Pritchard describes the subtlety of hypocrisy in that we ascribe the worst motives to others and we rename our sins to let ourselves off the hook. Like, if you do it, you're a liar, but I'm merely stretching the truth. If you do it, you're cheating, but I'm bending the rules. You lose your temper. I have righteous anger. You're a jerk. I'm just having a bad day. You have a critical spirit. I just say it like I see it. You gossip. I share prayer requests. Oh, boy. When you're driving and people go slower than you, they're idiots. And whoever drives faster than you is clearly a menace to safety, right? And so it goes. We all have 1,000 ways to excuse our own behavior while at the same time criticizing other people for doing the same things. We all have this measuring point at which we determine what is good and what is bad. Do you know what that measuring rod is? Think about it. Charles Swindoll brought this out well. He says, we all know that there are really, really bad people out there, and we dump in that pot like Hitler and Stalin and Judas Iscariot and Nero and Charles Manson, a host of other people into that category, maybe your next door neighbor. Then we have this real list of really, really good people to measure against. We say, well, okay, I'm no Mother Teresa, or I'm no Billy Graham, but I'm really not all that bad, you know, I'm a good person. But then there's this broad middle category, you know, of people who, are a bit naughty, mostly nice, some better than others. How do we determine which side they fall? Who's the measuring rod that you use? Who would you use? Don't say Jesus. That's the Sunday school answer for all the questions teacher asks, right? Yeah. Now, who is it really? It's yourself, right? It's yourself. Paul's point in chapter 2 is that this moral person is just as guilty as those who do all those things listed in chapter 1. Their sins may be different, but their guilt is the same. And the problem is that it's not easy to convince a moral person of their guilt because they truly believe that they're better than other people. That's how deeply sin has affected the human heart. And that's what Paul is trying to describe here at length. He exposes both the obvious and the subtle nature of sin. And so he writes, "Do you suppose, O man, that you will escape the judgment of God?" Since sin is so deeply embedded in the human soul, it's inescapable. Therefore, the judgment of God is also inescapable. We all want justice. When we stop to wonder why God doesn't just judge evil and just eliminate it, well, that's when we need to recognize that eliminating evil would mean the end of us. And what we really want is for God to get rid of the evil I don't like, or specifically the evil that's worse than the evil that's in my own heart. And clearly that kind of attitude will invite the wrath of God as fiercely as the person who's openly hostile to God's ways. Our hard, impenitent hearts are storing up wrath, Paul says in verse 5. Because the standard by which sin is weighed is not us giving it our best. It's God's standard of righteous perfection. And the only reason we've not been eliminated due to our sin is grace. Amazing grace. It's the gospel. That's where Paul's going with this as he develops our understanding of human sin and God's wrath. That's what this whole section's about. But it's the grace of God that steps in where the wrath of God would otherwise do us in. And Paul brings this out in verse 4. "Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance?" Repentance, that's grace. William Barclay said it this way, "The mercy and love of God are not meant to make us feel that we can sin and get away with it. They are meant to break our hearts that we will never seek to never sin again." Grace is for the moral person and for those openly filled with all manner of unrighteousness. Judgment is due to both, but grace is available to both. That's the gospel. And that brings us to the next section that deals with God's impartiality. We've already seen that it doesn't matter what categories of sin that we think are worse or better. Verse 6 to 11 basically tells us God doesn't play favorites, right? So that means no frequent attender bonuses for churchgoers, no free upgrades to soft padded seats, no free chocolates for those who come early, right? No free passes for anyone who thinks they are more deserving of God's lenience than someone else. You know those bad people out there? I know we'd be appalled if others heard our inside voice. Right, those thoughts of self-justification and criticalness towards others that are just bouncing inside our cranial space, mine and maybe yours too. Who wouldn't rather experience, as verse 10 says, glory and honor and peace for doing good, than verse 8 and 9, the wrath and fury and tribulation and distress for doing evil? As long as I get into my head that my religion means nothing, my nationality, race, color, heritage, position, affluence, philosophy of life, doesn't matter. Everyone will be judged by exactly the same standard as everybody else. God's impartial judgment is rendered according to our deeds, Paul goes on to explain. He's going to expand on that more in the next verses, but the basic truth remains. Our actions will come into view before the great courtroom of God, where every human being who's ever breathed will stand before God. And Paul's phrase is that he will render to each one according to his works. Verse 6, see it there? You know that's repeated several times in Scripture? Psalm 62, verse 12, "For you will render to a man according to his work." Proverbs 24, 12 asks, "Will he not repay man according to his work?" Matthew 16, 27, Jesus answers, "For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he's done." It's there. And it's all described in some detail in the book of Revelation. Now, don't everyone put their hand up at once. because there's clearly another part to this story, right? We're glad for that. I mean, the entire theme of this letter of the Romans is what? It's the gospel. And not being ashamed of the gospel. And I'd be pretty ashamed of this gospel if it got my hopes up, only then to face the same judgment as a murdering psychopath or a fraud that devours widows' pension funds. And that's where we need to clarify something again. Yes, the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. But in this part of Paul's development, he's speaking about sin. He's speaking about its consequences. And it's important to understand that no matter how good we think we are, each person will be judged by his or her deeds. Note, judged. They'll be judged by his or her deeds, not saved by his or her deeds. And there's the difference. No amount of doing good will tip the scales in our favor. God's righteous, holy standard will equally be applied to all people. The Jew, who thinks they've got special favors with God, they will not only find themselves facing God as judge, but they'll be first in line, the Jew first, and then the Gentile. You know, the God deniers who think their deeds will be good enough to get them by. They're going to be right in line behind them. And so what about this glory, honor, immortality being given to, and eternal life being given to everyone who does good in verse 7 and 10? Again, the grace of God shines through, right? Constantly through this section on human sin and divine wrath, not easy subject. Constantly there's this light of the gospel that calls people from darkness into God's light, from sin into salvation. So let's not read this without the context of the rest of Scripture. That we're given, we're promised glory, the radiance of God's presence and fullness. We're given honor, God's approval. We're given immortality, the joy of being in God's place with Him forever. We're given peace, the experience of God's wholeness. These are promised to those who believe in the one and only remedy God has given for sin. Salvation comes by grace alone. And doing good, then, is a response to the grace of God, not an attempt to gain the grace of God. That's the gospel. Now we're going to come to Romans 6:23 eventually as Paul develops his argument, but the gospel message is the same for all ages. The wages of sin is death. That's what's being emphasized in chapter 2. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. You see, no matter how much individuals might want to redefine or excuse or rationalize or deflect responsibility for personal wrongdoing, there is no working around the fact that God sees it all and He will hold us to account. Your best isn't good enough. That's the bad news. Don't wait for God's verdict on your sin until you breathed your last and can no longer do anything to invite the only work of justice that will acquit you before the judge of all the earth. Paul's message to us. One day our works will be judged. You will either stand on your own merit, meriting nothing, or you will stand under Jesus' merit, gaining everything. That's the gospel. That's why it's such incredibly good news. And if you're hearing this and you haven't ever seen it that way, maybe you've made some of those same excuses. You know, I'm a really good person. I'm sure you are. Or you'll take your chances with God. Well, do you think you're better than Mother Teresa or Billy Graham because they needed to repent of sin and receive God's gift of mercy through Jesus Christ? And if they did, you do too. Everyone does. It's that simple. Paul takes his development of God's judgment a step further, and then verse 12 to 16. Speaking of the universality of God's judgment, he responds here to those who would be quick to call God unfair. After all, the Jews had possession of God's law for like ever, right? And so they knew what God liked, they knew what God required, they knew what pleased God. Meanwhile, at that time, the Gentile nations historically did not. So how could they be judged according to the same standard? For that matter, all of us, everyone in the world has different accesses to information and different upbringings and different influences that point us toward or away from this exclusive path to life. Is that fair? Paul's response It's masterful. It's so important for us to understand. It also deals with the popular objection, well, what about people who've never heard the gospel? And if we did scan for the results on that, right? If we had that question in our minds, I'm sure we'd get a variety of answers. We've looked at this while unpacking Romans 1, verse 20, the evidence of creation to the whole world. And here, Paul argues for the evidence of conscience. Paul seems to imply, really, a two-tiered system of judgment. The Jewish people have had the law, so they're going to be judged according to the law, and the Gentile people who haven't had the law will be judged kind of according to a different law. And again, one could argue that God's not fair to judge people who have not known the truth about him in the same way that he would judge people who did have that truth. However, the point that Paul is actually making is that people will not be judged according to a standard they have not known. People will not be judged according to a standard they have not known. Just because people have had possession of his law doesn't mean they obeyed it, right? God will judge them on the grounds of what they've known and what they've obeyed or not obeyed about what they've known. Not just that they heard the truth or that they had it in their hands. On the other hand, there are lots of people who've never heard of God's standards, but they do instinctively the things that reflect God's standard. They do what is right. There's something inside the heart of people that compels them to keep the moral standards that God laid down even in the Ten Commandments. Generally speaking, cross-culturally, people know it is right and good to honor their parents. That murder and adultery and stealing and lying are wrong, and that lusting over other people or over things is only going to hurt ourselves or hurt others. That's 6 out of 10 commandments. People know this stuff even though they may never have heard or read a Bible verse. But it's one thing to know it, and yet another thing to do it, right? To obey what our conscience tells us is right. And that's Paul's point. That's the standard by which our actions are judged. At the end of days, God's final verdict will be rendered on each person according to that same universal standard. And it will be our understanding of right and wrong and what we did about it, and no one will be found guiltless. That's my cheery sermon for today. Have a great week. I mean, seriously, where would we be without the gospel? This good news that Jesus made a way, God's free gift in response to this very desperate condition. That's why we need it and why everyone needs it. Let me emphasize again that Paul is not offering an alternate method of salvation by being good or by obeying God's laws, the things that we know. He's highlighting the nature of human sin and that showing that our best efforts to do what is good will never be good enough. There's no workaround on this. The only way to life is through Jesus. And since Paul is writing to the church, right, the saints who are in Rome and Gentile church, and that by projection is us, we who are grateful to be forgiven through faith in Jesus need to weigh in on this too. Don't go judging people according to your standard of right and wrong. Hold up God's standard. Call people to take notice of God's one and only offer of pardon. In warning us not to judge, Paul isn't suggesting that we kind of close our eyes to the rampant evil around us, impacting our thoughts, impacting our attitudes and impulses, nor that we should ignore the influence of evil on our families and our community. God gave us his truth, and he gave us a conscience, and he expects us to use both of those to uphold justice and to help those who struggle due to their sin. And in warning us not to judge, he's warning us also of the insidious sin of hypocrisy. Let's not be holding others to a standard that we're not willing to keep ourselves. Repent of our own sin, and then we can have confidence to urge others to find that same grace that we found. Jesus used a rather extreme and somewhat hilarious visual aid in the Sermon on the Mount on this, just to help us get the point. He said, why do you see that speck, that little splinter? Ah, I see that splinter. Yeah, that's in your brother's eye, and don't notice the log that's in your own eye. Or how can you say to your brother, let me take that speck out of your eye when there's this log in your own eye? He says, you hypocrite. First take the log out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. The Lord wants us to care about what's right and wrong, not turn a blind eye, right? He wants us to equip us to be his agents of good, to stand against evil. He wants us to be able to help others who fail to see his ways correctly and who need not our judgment, but our help. And the best place to start doing that is right where you're sitting, right where I'm standing. We need to examine ourselves, confess sin, admit our misplaced standards of what's right and what's wrong, and see others as equally loved by God and needing his mercy. Same mercy he's shown us. Judgment, that coerces people to get in line or else. Rather, verse 4, God's kindness, his mercy to us through Jesus. That's what they need to hear about. Why? Because God intends that his kindness lead everyone to the same place, the place of repentance. There's no place in Christianity for elevating ourselves over those that we perceive of less value or as badder than us. See, God didn't save me, didn't reach out to me because of my awesomeness. Right? God didn't say, oh, there's a really skilled, good-looking specimen I need on my team. Let's save that guy. Let's save that woman. We need that person. No, that's not how God works. It's sheer mercy. Sheer mercy. For me, for you, for everyone. Praise God for his gospel. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're just in awe at the reach of your gospel. Not just to they and them, but to us. Not just the ones who could list a whole long series of bad things and bad choices in their lives, but us who've been relatively rescued from those things, but whose hearts are equally guilty. Thank you for the reach of your gospel to save everyone. Oh, Lord, help us to bear that message well. And Lord, thank you for your kindness that leads us to repentance. You know what every one of us needs to repent of even now. Maybe this has triggered a thought or a reminder. And Lord, I pray that there would be some who just bend their knee in repentance of sin for you even the first time today. Receive that great gift of your salvation that you've offered. Lord, I thank you that human sin and the wrath of God isn't the end of the story. I thank you for the deliverance that came through Jesus. Fill our hearts with gladness about that. We sung about it. We're going to leave happy about that. Fill our lips and our hearts with that for those who need it. Help us to help those who need to cross that line to Jesus. We thank you for your grace to us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
We deserve nothing but his wrath, and we get everything in his mercy. May God be our vision, our wisdom. May we not seek after riches or empty praise from man. The song, Be Thou My Vision, we have an added section that says, O God, be my everything, be my delight, be Jesus my glory, my soul satisfied. Stand and sing together. Thank you.
good. Good to end with our vision on the Lord as we finish out our time. Next Sunday, we're going to take a break from Romans, and we're going to start a new series, Preparing Our Hearts for the Anticipation of the Birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, with an Advent series called The Gift. And so I hope you'll be looking forward to that. May God bless you with a rich, Christ-filled week as you go from here. There's coffee time downstairs. You can take that outside. It's still a little bit balmy-ish for this time of year. We get to enjoy that outside. God bless you until we meet again. Mm-hmm.